Vinny Smile Chopra, a man who took $7 to a portfolio of over $250 million in apartment investing. He mentors and coaches to make apartment syndication easy. Each week, he will share his expertise, tricks, trades, and golden nuggets how to master the art of syndication to bring cash flow streams to your business, to change your life for the better. Here is Mr. Smiles.
Hi, guys. This is Syndication Made Easy with Vinny Chopra, also known as Mr. Smiles. Mr. Smiles is a number one international best-selling author for his book called Apartment Syndication Made Easy. So this podcast is something you're going to want to listen to if you're getting into the apartment syndication business, because I'm going to talk to Mr. Chopra here about at the SEC and how exactly this works in the apartment syndication world. Vinny, how are you today?
I'm doing great. Thank you, Alicia. Thank you for joining this morning, guys. It's a wonderful morning here in California, in the Danville area. Yeah.
Yeah, no, and I think this is definitely, if you're in business, in this type of business, you need to be listening to this podcast because the SEC is not somebody you want to mess with.
Yeah, that's so true. So true. I do want to put a disclaimer, guys. Yes. I'm not a CPA. I'm not an attorney or an SEC attorney like that. I've done 27 syndications, and all of them have been 506B, as in boy. I do have 506C, which I'll explain. I know some of the people might be saying, what are these numbers about? See, when we do raise money, if two people get together and one person gives the money to the other person and says, invest for me, and you are making decision for investing that money for profit in any kind of business, it's a syndication. A lot of people nowadays are doing joint contracts and LLCs and things like that. You know, the thing is, you have to be very careful. You can have a tenants in common, which is TIC, it's called, tenants in common. What that means is every member of the LLC is actively participating. That's the word, actively, not passively. So if everybody on a daily basis is making decisions for the profits of that organization, that's tenants in common. Again, I'm disclaiming, saying a disclaimer that I'm not an attorney. That's what I understand. So please do your own investigation. Yes. And talking to attorneys and find the right LLC structure and things like that. But the big thing is, once you should always be doing business in real estate where the property is bought by a limited liability corporation or land trust. Some people use land trusts. I don't really get into all that to hide your name and everything and all. Limited liability corporations do very similar stuff with Wyoming, with Las Vegas LLCs, Delaware LLCs. I know all three are very big in my books. We love, you know, all three of them. But the big thing is the property that you're purchasing needs to be in the state. The LLC, Limited Liability Corporation, of that state should be formed because you have to work within those premises, within those guidelines of that state. So that's how we have been doing it. The limited liability company that makes that buys the property is in that particular state. Okay. Like that. So let's bring SEC into it. Now, SEC is Securities and Exchange Commission. It's a branch of the government, federal government, that, and also local also, by the way, you have to abide by the rules of SEC, Securities and Exchange Commission. When you're purchasing something, and you have to register yourself if you're pooling the money together. By the way, you must be thinking, wow, okay, what's happening with the companies? All the companies also pool money together, remember?
Yeah.
Because they sell shares of stock. So it's the same thing you are doing. You're buying an apartment complex in our case, and then we are selling shares, $1,000 share per share or $5,000 per share stock to the investors so that they would be able to come into the deal, become a part of the deal. They'll own that deal, right? Ownership, mm-hmm. it's called, of the apartment community, we call it, like in our case. So in simpler words, we are buying some shares of the property and we are legally owners of that apartment community. Okay. All right. Very similar to when there is a company outside like Google or Facebook or whatever, right? Mm-hmm. When people are buying that company shares, they are also becoming owner of that company, as small it might be. If there are 20 million shares or 100 million shares, then you are very small, right? If you buy a few number of shares. In apartment community, you can have as many, people who can invest in. In our case, we try to keep 100,000 minimum for investment. We take some 50,000 also, but mostly 100,000, because then we can control the number of investors that are becoming owners of the community, apartment community.
Okay. Now, is it the rules? Like, I don't know much about it, but I do know that in our past conversations and from your book, about when you're talking with investors when it comes to the SEC, like you have to talk to them certain amount of times, or how does that work?
Yes, you hit the nail on the head. Actually, it's called pre-existing relationships. It's so important that we need to start talking to investors, family, friends, people we have at work, all the people like that. We need to be building relationship, it's called, pre-existing relationship before you ask them to invest in your future deal. That's the word future. You cannot have a deal today and then start talking to the investors after the date you got the deal. Right. It's called post then, right? But you cannot show that deal to the people you're going to meet after that. You need to be talking to the investors before the deal that you get it under contract, and then you share with them and they can decide to invest with you or not invest with you. So the biggest thing I try to tell my students is you got to be always spinning two plates, the big two plates, I say five in my book, but the two of the biggest plates, first one is the investor's plate and the relationship building and the making the lists and the CRM, the customer retention software you should have. The other one is the brokers. Mm-hmm. So the brokers, you also need to be dealing with that plate in the emerging area where you're going to purchase the apartment complex. So you need to be talking to brokers, building relationship, making lists, getting deals, underwriting deals.
Is that from the SEC or no? Like, do you have to have a relationship?
SEC doesn't dictate the broker's relationships.
Okay.
The SEC dictates the investor's portion right over here, which is the big part of it. If we have no investors, we have no deal. Yeah. I mean, unless you have lots of millions of dollars and you can, buy yourself, that's one thing. The big thing happens with the combining the forces. Syndication in simple world means like-minded people getting together, putting their investments together for bigger acquisition or for bigger cause to make profits, right? Mm-hmm. That's syndication, pooling of the money of the like-minded people. But then few of us become specialists or we learn the tricks of the trade. We do a lot of coaching, mentoring, learn from all the coaches and mentors. And then we are now in a position to buy a deal. First of all, we have to analyze a deal and find out if it's good or bad or how it's going to grow in value, all those things, right? So then those are the techniques. Then you get a loan. You have to be able to qualify for the loan, which is my plate number four, I think, So that's important because unless you qualify for a loan, your net worth has to be more than the loan itself. Otherwise, you won't get the loan. So all those things have to play out for a syndicator to really get a property under LOI, letter of intent, then to acceptance, which is the purchase and sales agreement, PSA, we call it, from letter of intent to PSA where the attorneys talk. Now it's a binding contract for purchase. Now comes putting a package together, information packet for the investors, because the investors have been talked to that we are purchasing around in this area in Dallas or Georgia or Texas or Florida. So then they need to know why they should invest. So that's the information packet. Then the syndication attorney needs to be called, and then he or she needs to make a private placement memorandum, PPM, we call it. PPM is private placement memorandum with the operating agreement and the subscription agreement. Those are the three documents which are provided to the future investor. So the investors that we already have in our database, we reach out to them, those who have already set their goals and everything. They have told that we would like to invest with you. So that is a huge part. We need to be doing a webinar to only those people that we have pre-existing relationships, unless we are doing a public, it's not a public offering, but it's like 506C. What's the difference between the two?
I don't.
506B and C? The only thing is in the 506B exemption of the Regulation D, more jargon, you know, from SEC. But the thing is, we are able to take an exemption of 506B and register it so that we can only talk to the people we already know, and we can talk to accredited investors and sophisticated investors. Those are the two investors, right? Sophisticated are the ones who know about investing in stock. Mm-hmm. They have learned, they have been to some seminars, they're sophisticated, but they're not making $1 million net worth. They don't have $1 million net worth, not including the primary residence.
Okay.
That is, if they're over $1 million, then they're accredited in net worth, not counting the residence, or they can be making $200,000 individual or $300. I know, like Kim Taylor, my, you know, syndication attorney and friend, she talks about 1-2-3 rule. $1 million, $200,000 making personally, or $300,000 making as a spouse and the both the spouses making 300. If you're doing one of those three things, then you are accredited investor. Now, accredited investors can be investing in all the deals. Most of the people love to work with accredited investors, but sophisticated investors, you can get up to 35 of them in a 506B. But in the 506C, you cannot get sophisticated investors at all. They all have to be accredited investors. That's the choice. And in 506C, you can advertise to the world. Oh my gosh. Huh. So there is more on social media everywhere, advertisement, YouTube, whatever, Facebook. You can advertise, have a website also for the 506C. Crowdfunding, by example, right? That's 506C, because that's where you're advertising and opening to anybody to invest in there. So that's where the C comes in. But the B is with pre-existing relationship investors.
And what else does the SEC like what are the other rules besides the fact of the relationship aspect prior to the deal?
Okay, good point. Very good point. SEC ruling also says that you cannot pay commissions to anybody for raising money. What that means is you have to be a broker-dealer. A broker-dealer is somebody who goes through different certifications and everything, and then they are becoming a broker-dealer. They could sell the security. That's the word. They could sell the security to other clients and get paid for it. But in our case, where we are in the 506B or C, we have to have partners who are able to do a lot more things than just raising money. So we are able to bring partners in the manager side, general partner side, we call it.
Okay.
Limited partner is where the investors come in, LP. We call them LP for limited partners, and they invest 50,000 or 100,000 or 200,000. They're limited partner by the name passive investing.
Okay.
And see, they're passively investing. The they are not really getting in the active side, not on the general partner side, but they are investing their money and then they're sleeping at night and hoping that the syndicators or the, you know, nice experts in the business are able to manage the assets and bring about the cash flows to them, right? Yeah. So passively investing is just like the word being passive. You are not actively making decisions. You are not bothered by everyday hassles of the property management mm-hmm. and, you know, residents or the tenants calling for toilet doesn't work and this and that. So that's peace of mind. That's for passive. Peace of mind, passive investing. And a lot of people have a lot of money nowadays, you know, in retirement plans, which is my goal, is to educate how to really transfer that money from the Wall Street into self-directed retirement plans.
IRAs.
And then inspect, yeah. Then invest. So QRPs are very QRPs, yeah. EQRP, self-directed IRAs, self-directed 401ks, solo, Roth IRAs. All those are very, very prominent now. But a lot of people don't know that they could go from Wall Street, take the mutual fund money out, invest it into the, you know, the self-directed accounts, and then they are able to invest that into syndications. Of course, in the Wall Street, you could put into REITs, R-E-I-T-S, REITs. Uh-huh. That's the real estate investment trusts, where they are big, big companies, huge companies, and they buy bigger portfolios, but the returns are lower as compared to individual syndications where you become a part of the apartment complex community, you own a percentage of that.
Mm-hmm. That makes sense.
Yeah.
So is that, and then as long as you're pretty much doing right by your investors and you're doing the right thing both by the investment itself, you're pretty okay with the SEC rulings, like you're not going to get in too much trouble.
Trouble, exactly. So true. You know, they want you to run very clean operation. SEC is a watchdog. It's a watchdog, which I like it on the part of investors to make sure that the syndicators are doing their job correctly. They're transparent. They are holding meetings. They are taking care of the needs of the investors. They want to make sure that none of the investors are disgruntled so that they call on and put an investigation into yeah. the, you know, what you are dealing and things like that. So you got to run your operation like a business, you know, not an idea, but a business, and make sure that you're meeting, properly communicating with the, like we do quarterly meetings with our investors, live meetings on Zoom. We record them live, and then we send them to all the investors that evening or next day. Those who could not see it, they could see it that way. And then we have portals where investors can go in, check out financial records and everything on the properties and all like that. Yep. Yep.
That's awesome. That's awesome. And so, and again, we're clarifying, Vinny is not an SEC attorney.
Yes.
Or a CPA. He has just been in the business for a minute and has been around the block. Obviously, he knows a lot of the terminology. I think I felt like you just read it out of a book. but so I think that, and, this, and if you guys want to know more about, you know, to make sure you're staying in line with the SEC, always, again, comment below, like, subscribe. You guys reach out to Vinny. But before we go, I want to get my nugget of advice from Vinny, because we get one every show. Vinny, if, you know, okay, let's say, I've got the investor part down. You know, I know I have to build the relationship first before I could show them an investment. So I got that part down. But what would be your advice after that point for somebody that's new into the business about dealing with the SEC?
Oh, sure. I would say, no, definitely you want to keep the interest. We all have fiduciary responsibility to protect the investment of the investors, first of all, better than even our money. We need to protect their money first, right? The second thing is to be totally communicative all through the dealing with the investors for 4, 5, 6 year hold. Whenever we are going to sell the property, we need to be holding meetings and sending them monthly reviews. If you can, monthly newsletters are great to let them know what's happening at the asset, things like that. Bring the property pictures into the presentation. That's a huge part, because not too many investors fly all the way across the country to be at the properties and things like that.
The whole point of being passive is that.
Yeah, passive. Yeah. Exactly. And attend to their communication, their questions, very straightforward, and be open-minded, you know, and all. And then if you're raising money for a syndicator, make sure you're part of the general, GP side on the manager LLC, and make sure you are having more than one job of just raising money. You need to be analyzing, you need to be doing, research, you need to be underwriting, you need to be due diligence, get involved as much as you can so that you can learn the business and represent the management company so that you are not just getting paid for just raising money.
Makes sense. All right, guys, you just got your weekly, I guess this would be your weekly SEC kick in the butt from Mr. Smiles. This is Syndication Made Easy. Vinny, I appreciate your time. Maybe one day we'll have an SEC attorney on here.
Yeah, we will. We would love that. Kim Taylor is amazing. Kim Lisa Taylor, I'll call her. She would love to be in our show.
Yeah, and then maybe we can get a bunch of questions from your students.
Wonderful.
And then I can ask them with her. Yep. And we can kind of drill in. Because, I know you know a lot, but we can get somebody on here as a professional that does this for a living. Would be great.
No, that'll be amazing. I just shared this stage with her in Orlando last week. She was there and she did a fabulous job. She's done 26 of my syndication packets. She's one of the best in the nation. So I would love to have her come on board. I'll reach out to her. Yeah.
Awesome. Well, thank you, Vinny, so much. Love the information as usual. Guys, you can text LEARN to 474747, or you can reach out to Vinny on his website at vinnychopra.com. All of his information will be here in the show notes. And Vinny, I hope you have a great week. And
I will catch up with you next week. You take care.
Okay.
Bye-bye, guys. See you next week. Bye-bye.
Be sure to listen to Mr. Smiles next week with more golden nuggets and top-notch coaching tips. You can reach him by going to vinnychopra.com or texting the word syndication to 474747. Be sure to like, comment, and share to show everyone how Mr. Smiles has brought your apartment syndication business to the next level.